Dr. Sophia Nymphaeus. Sophia is an internationally recognized researcher and practitioner for her contributions to improving applied practice in sport. She's a professor at Edith Cowan University with a collaborative role as high performance manager for Softball Western Australia. Thankfully, in 2021, women's softball is back on the Olympic program. Really exciting. She's worked as a sports scientist and strength and conditioning coach in the US and Australia with national, Olympic, and professional teams and athletes. Welcome, Dr. Nymphaeus, to the show.
Thanks for that introduction. We're going to jump straight into this because we don't have a lot of time with 15 minutes. And I know you've been watching a lot of presentations today. So just to wake us up, let's do a little bit of a live poll. So many of you may be familiar with watching movement. So I'd just like you to identify which one of the individuals on the screen, A or B, is the person you believe is the female athlete squatting. And if you're unsure, you can do C. I'm not going to give you much time. I want to see you have your first intuition and place that in. We'll talk about that a little bit later, maybe in the question and answer session. But as we go through, we need to get some definitions down. And the definition for this talk, particularly because I said this is a talk about female athletes, is the gender or sex talk. Now, gender is related to the terms woman, women, girls, and it's one gender identity. The IOC uses this identification for sport participation. On the other hand, in the research, we're often talking about sex. And the reason for that are the biological underpinnings we use to explain the conclusions. So we use the term female athlete or female player, but by definition, female biologically is associated with those that can produce eggs or young. So we essentially boil people down to eggs. So that's why I say female athlete as an adjective and not just that you're eggs, I mean females. So I'm using female athletes in this talk because there are other purported sex differences that we're interested in research. But I'd like to highlight that even in the neurosciences, we're starting to go away from that idea that you can exclusively research sex or gender separately, because we live in a world where those interactions occur, and we will talk about that. So they're using the term gender/sex together so that we stop identifying that it is merely a biological underpinning when it may not be. So beyond that, what I'd like to talk about are the three primary areas really quickly that people usually mention around kind of that dreaded biology of the female athlete, which is how it comes out when you read the research. The first area that even comes up in common language is this idea of, well, they're just built differently. So the anthropometry of the athlete. And they state things such as intercondylar notch width, the Q angle, and of course your pelvic width. But interestingly, if you read the research a little bit more critically, there's very little to none that's actually measured injured athletes and non-injured athletes and female athletes, showing that they have significantly higher values of any of those anthropometries. And when we look at the research further, we actually identify that men and women have very similar Q angles, and particularly when they're of the same height. The next area is hormones or joint laxity, which I usually go to male athletes tear their ACLs. Yes, they do. And I'm talking about injury and ACL because we do mostly research female athletes when they get injured and not so much in the other aspects. But some interesting research from Michaela Bruton has identified that there's a lot of other factors that explain the differences in their movement than those things. And they just don't hold up. And this is going to come into this idea about the whole system and the perception of the last area that people often conclude that the female athletes just move different. They have biomechanical differences in movement. But what Michaela identified was that actually, once you equate the amount of practice time and therefore the subsequent skill attained, that those differences wash out. And in sports like downhill skiing and in sports especially like dance, where female athletes start at younger ages, those gender differences that we identify in the rate of injury actually decline. So it makes us question, is it the system creating the female athlete? Or is it, as we've been concluding, that it's the female athlete and it is them that has caused this increased risk of injury? And that's a big difference in your conclusion. It's a massive difference, in fact, because one, you can't change or it's inherent to the person. The other, we have to ask the system to change. And that often costs money and time and a lot of explanation as to why we haven't been doing it thus far. So it's not what you say, it's how you say it. Well, kind of. Sometimes it's exactly how you say it. And if you read the conclusions of a lot of the research, we literally frame the female athlete into believing that they are doomed to said outcomes. We make broad conclusions about female athletes as a whole in series and time after time of research articles. Even to this day, I look them up and I read them, and it's not changing as rapidly as it should. We're not acknowledging that we actually can't group an entire group into a movement pattern. There's as much within group difference as there is between group. And when I'm talking about between groups, I mean between group difference between female athletes and male athletes to within group difference of the female athletes and the male athletes. And if you don't believe me, then we'll have a look at a couple of things. So actually, when we look at this male and female athlete difference, I mean, it's a popular topic, no doubt. And that has perpetuated us being able to state these things unequivocally without criticism. But a couple of key articles have come out. This article by Ann Benjamin in 2011, and then the article I mentioned before by Michaela Bruton, really questioning if there is a difference in movement from Ann. Is it large enough to matter? Is it bigger than even the error that we have in the biomechanics research equipment we use? It's pretty questionable. And is the difference a function of this training age or her motor experience that Michaela talks about throughout the article? And they're really, really strong suggestions. But again, it's a much more complicated story to tell than simply female athletes are X. And even in the psychology research that has much more data than in the exercise and sports science research, they're reframing that idea that there's more gender similarities than differences. But I'm not saying there's none. I'm just saying, should they have the preponderance of discussion and focus that they do? Or is that just a scapegoat for the reality of what we should be focusing on? And just in case you're wondering, that metasynthesis, which is multiple meta-analyses, concluded that the things that actually had large effect differences were that masculine and feminine traits, kind of inherent, the importance of beauty in mates, which, like in Australia, we were curious about that. Men care about their friends' beauty? No, that's the person you mate with, and aggression versus what women have. But I want you to look at those. I'm not just bringing them up for a bit of a laugh. But you notice these effect sizes being 0.7 at the highest for the most kind of that's obvious kind of factor of a 0.7. Well, what that actually looks like, and if you would make these broad sweeping conclusions for the way we conclude about male athletes versus female athletes, you'd think that the effect difference was a 5. This is what it looks like. There's almost no overlap. But in reality, most of the time, the difference is around 0.2. That's the smallest detectable change we care about. And when we have effect differences that happen to be significant, but are only 0.2, 92% of the people are overlapping. Would you call that a significant difference? Noting that, would you go back to the research and have a look at it? And even in the obvious masculine versus feminine traits in the psychology research, this is what 0.7 in effect difference looks like. That's still 72% of us overlapping. That's not exactly the sweeping broad generalizations that we end up concluding in the research. So I guess this quote really means a lot. Differences that may appear at a cursory level to be due to essential differences between the sexes may in fact be due, in part or completely, to some additional confounding variables. Now, confounding variables is something I can deal with, because you can control those things, you can measure them, and at least you should be reporting them in the research. And things are changing. Women in sport over the years has vastly changed from what we had in 1967, having to sneak our way into the Boston Marathon, to Title IX and this vast increase in participation at the high school level, over 900, almost 1,000% increase, and at the intercollegiate level, vastly amazing. And then more recently, equal pay pursuits. But here's something that probably explains a lot more of these quote-unquote confounding variables I'm going to go into. In a 2012 survey of high school strength and conditioning coaches, we noticed a curious trend. Strength and conditioning coaches for all these female athletes that have to be included based on Title IX, those coaches were more commonly uncertified and less experienced. So they may be having the opportunities, but they're not afforded the coaches that can teach them the motor skill and give them the knowledge in order to feel comfortable doing all the things in order to be effective movers. So it puts a different spin on it. And it starts to bring out these ideas from two major theories of Newell's models of constraints, that the individual is intertwined with the environment and their task. And if that task is too difficult relative to the constraints of the individual, they're going to have to change the way they move. And the way they move and the individual constraints are probably a function of how all the sociocultural factors from Albert Bandura's theory that have contributed to that individual. But that's not inherent. That's a function of a system. And that's a totally different discussion to the way that we're mostly concluding things. And so I'm going to draw our attention to a couple of articles. One, we went ahead and we went, you know, one of the confounding variables that I think is happening here is that we're not even measuring or controlling for strength. And we're not doing research to compare male and female athletes to find out the effect of strength. We really want to find out if there are these differences between the sexes so we can target those things effectively. But people don't report and measure strength. So we strength matched individuals and then looked at some of the common ratios of muscle activity, and we found no significant differences between the group. But within group, a whole lot of variability. So men, the male athletes and the female athletes had a great range of variability, but when you compared between, there was no real difference. Well, that's different to a lot of the research that has concluded there is one, but then curiously, a lot of that research didn't even control for or even oftentimes discuss that it just may be in the strength. And we know that strength is fully modifiable, and the rate of adaptation between resistance training programs for male and female athletes is similar. They may adapt in a different way, but the magnitude is indeed similar. And so we have to question, are all our conclusions a function of capacity? Well, that's way too simplistic. Then we look at another article here looking at dexterity, how you control your strength, essentially. And they found that when you look at recreational male and female athletes, they were found to have a big difference. But when you looked at proper elite Olympic level athletes, there was no difference. So our sampling method and whether skilled athletes or recreational athletes are equivocal skill between male and female athletes is questionable. Just based on what I talked about the reduction in the experience and the certification of coaches that are given to female athletes in high school that eventually remain as recreational athletes, probably indicating they don't get the same motor experience. But once you get to elite, you're elite and your skill is equated. And then things such as dexterity seem to not be so different between the male and female athletes. So we have to start considering whether it is the capacity and skill or multitudes of these confounding variables, years of experience, or like I was saying, their motor experience or resistance training experience before we conclude things. In this article that we had previously, we had male and female athletes jumping and concluded that there was a difference in the eccentric phase impulse and the concentric phase. But when we resampled that data and we looked at it between stronger and weaker individuals, the results got stronger. Broader, there were bigger differences in those impulse places. And so what that indicated to us was beyond just the sex of the individual, actually the strength of the individual contributed more to that conclusion. And we could have changed the entire paper instead of making it a difference between male and female athletes to a difference in stronger and weaker athletes. If we're going to dichotomize, we might as well dichotomize. So it brings that question, is strategy a function of capacity? And in some interesting research by Norden and Dufek, Janet Dufek, leading some of these things, is really fascinating work, they found that when individuals were placed under a task that was more and more difficult by adding load or adding height in a drop jump, that they constrained the number of motor solutions they had. They had less principal components. The analogy I often give is if you have to pick up a pebble or an Atlas stone, there's very few ways you can innovate to pick up the Atlas stone, but plenty of ways in order to pick up the pebble. And this has been brought about in Schmitz and Schultz's early research. They started trying to tease out this idea of strength influencing it. Didn't quite get there, but they did highlight that the strength influenced it, but it couldn't explain all of the variance and the amount of absorption at the knee. And it's probably because it's not perfectly linear. So we went on to look at a couple of other things and identified that movement strategy really does affect the athlete as well and differently. when you look at this here, you'll notice that this athlete up here is vastly influenced by an unanticipated sidestep in this scenario, increasing amount of knee to hip absorption ratio, but some athletes much more affected than others. So not only do we need to look at the sex or the gender of the athlete, we have to consider the within variation, the individual movement strategy as being critical. And we have to realize that we have to get athletes, even if we do improve their capacity through strength, to be able to adapt their control after we've changed their muscle properties. These things aren't coming through clear in the literature. And so we saw and we repeated some of the ideas around looking at higher, moderate, and lower strength individuals instead of by gender. And again, that same idea, the conclusions are stronger when we look at it by strength than they are by gender. And what happened is as we increased the height of the drop jump, there was a shift to the amount of work done at the knee. That might be explanatory for why our female athletes are injuring their knees. But it's not because of their inherent properties. It's because they haven't been trained to move, given the coaches to move, and or they don't have the strength. But not because they're incapable and not because it's inherent. Because those things are trained in everybody. So transfer of training will vary by individual, and one must consider that dance between improvements in physical capacity and the ability to learn to utilize this capacity during a skilled movement. And this seems really logical. So I guess the thing I just wanted everyone to have a think about is to be more critical of the research. Is it really even beneficial for these sex differences and gender differences to be purported? Well, yes, but the why behind it needs to come through. The conclusion isn't females are different. Female athletes are different. No. The question is why? And if they haven't controlled for a series of confounding variables, then actually we haven't learned much at all. In fact, we maybe have just learned about what happens when you don't have the motor experience, the expertise of coaching, a system that provides adequate support throughout the length of the career, and improved strength base that is a function of all of the things that are provided to athletes in theory. So the take-home message is when you're reading research and you're trying to conclude what do we know about female athletes, have they even considered, measured, and corrected for strength? Have they described, controlled, or even explained about their motor skill or familiarity with the skill being measured? And have they considered the individual differences that occur even within the group instead of just grouping a conclusion holistically? Thank you so much. I know I've gone a little bit over time, but I'd like to thank all of my scholars that are here that have been a big part of all of the work that we've done and continuing to do. And then, of course, all of the people that have influenced me through my career, my mentors, starting from when I was an athlete. Thank you very much, all the way through to completing my PhD. I couldn't have done it without all of you. And I hope you've learned something here today. So thank you for attending. And if you have any questions.